Live streaming is on.
Live streaming is on.
Hello? Hello?
Hello, sir. Hello.
Oh, yes. Hello. Good afternoon.
Hello. Good afternoon.
A very good afternoon, sir.
Afternoon. Good afternoon. So, how is the situation in Aurangabad right now?
Not so very good, sir. All are trying to follow all the norms and stay safe.
I mean, I really wonder if all do follow norms, because in Mumbai, it's becoming a bit difficult that quite a lot of people don't follow the norms.
Yeah.
And some norms become difficult to follow.
Yes.
Yes, ma'am. May I start, ma'am?
Yeah, I think ask the technical team, so Navne sir, and we can go.
Sorry, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We can start.
Okay, okay. Thank you. Thank
is it? Is it? Yes, sir. Shall we start?
Yeah, I think we are 5 minutes ahead of time, so we can do it. No worries.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Yes. A very good afternoon to one and all. I, Jaykumar Sriram Dage, Assistant Professor in the CEC Department, welcome you all for the expert guest lecture on open source and its application. I would like to introduce our today's speaker, Mr. Krishnakant Mane sir. Yesterday I sent you a few videos. I hope you have seen that videos. Krishnakant Mane sir is a well-known personality. If you recall one of the episodes of Satyamev Jayate hosted by Amir Khan, you will get all these things. Krishnakant Mane sir, popularly known as KK, was invited by the said celebrity to discuss his ideas about digital freedom and open knowledge sharing to build a better nation. Krishnakant Mane sir is an accessibility expert and a free software advisor working as a consultant to many government and large commercial enterprises. He has been promoting the use of free software, also called as open source, so that people have freedom to use, modify and redistribute software in an openly competitive market. With a software engineering background, Krishnakant Mane sir has 10 years of experience and more than that now in languages like Python and PHP. He has been working actively with enterprises like Sun Microsystems, Red Hat to make technologies usable to disabled people, particularly for blind community. As a software engineer and system architect, Krishnakant is currently leading the development of GNUKhata, a modular, scalable and robust free accounting software. GNUKhata will provide a complete free and open source replacement to proprietary software like Tally, and we will be aimed at organizations involved in activities like microfinance, self-help groups, etc. The software on the other side is a powerful, easy to use and feature rich commercial, and it is going to be used, it is because the user is charged and there is no license fee for it, there is no charge and it is used for multiple machines too. He has worked with Homi Bhabha Center for Science Education of TIFR as a project fellow on Self Portal. He has also successfully led the True Vision project with Electronic Corporation of Tamil Nadu, ELCOT. This project was aimed at training visually handicapped people in use of free software and become self-dependent. A visionary person and a firm advocate of open knowledge sharing, he has a mission to make all village IT enabled so that rural community comes at power with the people in cities and thus build a better nation. About DFF in short, the organization is inspired by the impact of free and open source software, that is FOSS, popularly the term is FOSS, on the digital technology. Digital Freedom Foundation aims to raise the quality of education and employment in rural sector using free software. In a common terminology, a software, already you are aware of, a computer program is what makes your computer, mobile phone, ATM machines to perform certain tasks, right? So we are all software engineers and we are doing the programming, okay? So without wasting the time, I would like to request head of department, Dr. Smita L. Kasar ma'am, to say few words on this topic.
Thank you, Dage sir. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. A very good afternoon to all of you, respected Krishnakant Mane sir, Dr. Sonamne sir, Mr. Dage sir, and all the students who have joined us for this webinar today. On behalf of Computer Science and Engineering Department, Maharashtra Institute of Technology, I heartily welcome Mr. Krishnakant Mane for this webinar on open source and its applications. So believe me, it is indeed a very, very great privilege to welcome you here for the interaction, because it is not only about the technical terms or the technically guiding the students, but it is like I'm very much sure that after today's webinar, all these students are definitely going to get a vision. We usually keep on talking about owing back something to the society. But then Krishnakant sir is a very good example, an excellent example of what he is doing back for the society as an engineer, as a software engineer. Talking more about free and open source software is many a times we usually download the applications and we are very much interested to use the free and open source softwares. But then we really need to find out how much percentage of software engineers are really contributing to this stream. I think this percentage, once it is increased, it is definitely going to a revolutionary change in the society. Like what is the vision of Krishnakant sir, to have digital freedom for all the rural community as well. People who do not want proprietary software on that, they cannot spend on that rather. So for them, it is really required. And for this, we all as software engineers, I think, need to have a vision to contribute more towards it. So with this, I again heartily welcome Krishnakant sir, and I would like to extend my thanks to you, sir, that you have spared time to talk to our students. Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Over to you, Dagi, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. So again, I welcome Mr. Krishnakant Mane, sir. Sir, all the students are eagerly waiting for you. Please, sir, guide them and motivate them. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you. So first of all, thanks. And MIT is not something which I'm very new to. I've been visiting MIT since 2012 or something. So it's around 8 years. This is not the first time. Maybe this is the first time I'm virtually joining in, but this is not the first time I am attuned to MIT. And quite a few interns have worked with us. It is just that before I go ahead, I would give a few updates, because I think in the introduction, probably the information you had was quite an old information. So of course, I would add a few things to it. And and this is very much in context, because today I decided not just to talk about the open source and its applications, but it's very important to talk about what careers students can make about with open source. Because you see, right from Visual Studio Code till Azure, till Red Hat Enterprise Servers, till Java, till MySQL, till MongoDB, you talk about all the microservice frameworks like Django, you talk about Node.js, you talk about React, you talk about Angular, you talk about what? Docker. See, everything you talk about now is open source. Everything. There are very few proprietary technologies, so to speak, which are really very active in today's IT world. And that is the reason we must understand that we shouldn't be taking for granted certain things, because ma'am rightly said, we just download and we use it. Okay. I mean, I am not expecting any of you right away to start contributing to some great open source project and do some social work. It's not possible. Okay. One has to really give a life to it. And having said that, it is not even impossible. I mean, there are Google Summer of Codes, and then there are several hackathons happening. Now, hackathon was a very new word back then in 2012-13, but now everyone knows, even government talks about hackathon. So basically, I am also a CTO of a company called Bookmatic Private Limited, which is what I founded last year. And if you go to www.onlinekhata.co.in, that's O-N-L-I-N-E, online as in online, and khata as in account, K-H-A-T-A, onlinekhata.co.in. That is actually, Dage sir was talking about GNU Khata. Basically, Online Khata is a rebranded enterprise version of GNU Khata, wherein we give more enterprise features. That is not free, of course, but it is not costly as well. I mean, if you have to pay just 1,000 rupees for a year for a small micro or small business who has a very simple business and they cannot afford huge ERPs, they cannot even afford Tally. Like Tally charges you a lot as compared to what we do. And people who don't want complex softwares, people who want that, what we have done is like they make their bills and invoices, all your stationery shops and all your grocery stores and your, your tailors, courier service providers, lawyers, doctors, medical stores. See, they don't have time to do accounting and they don't understand accounting. So they have to spend on an accountant. They have to give money to an accountant to do data entry and all that stuff. What we did is, we totally eliminated the need for going to the accountant for that data entry. When you make your bill or invoice, the accounting entries are automatically generated. And let me tell you, friends, quite a lot of this code has been written by some of your students, of some of my interns coming from MIT 2 years back, because last year was a lockdown. So there was a lot of, you know, Ulta Palat happening, all this haywire hanky pank happening around. But before that, I'm talking about. So the base was laid by some of your students. Now, to start with, that product is an open source thing. But then we made an enterprise version to give it to a very specific small and micro sector at a very affordable rate. So you see what open source can do, what open source, what wonders they can do, right? And of course, I was talking about Visual Studio Code sometime back. See, you see that it was Visual Studio first. It was belonging to Microsoft. It still belongs to Microsoft. I was just talking with my wife sometime back, and I was checking Visual Studio Code sometime back. There's a reason why I was doing that, and I'll come to that. I see so much of improvement. I see so much high quality stuff happening there. I was shocked. You know, I am an Emacs user, and I don't know how many of you students know what Emacs or Vim is. It's a high quality premium thing. It's like, you know, the heaven or the Mecca of programmers. Those who know Emacs and Vim would know what I'm talking about. I am a hardcore Emacs user. And when I saw Visual Studio today, I was shocked. And I immediately told my wife that this is open source ka jadu. The time when it was restricted to only Microsoft labs, it was only that much they could do. There was a limit. The moment you make it open source and the moment you have contributors like you guys, and when I say contributors, I just don't mean just doing it for your final year project or just doing it as a social service. I also include those people who get paid for doing it. Why not? I mean, one has to be paid for whatever good work they do. So you see, when open source happens, when community is allowed to participate in a certain thing, when a community is given a stage wherein any person can come and talk and you will be screened. If you're really doing something good, we don't care who you are in, you know. Even if you are a dropout or a backbencher, you are in. That is what open source is. And that is why you have React. And that is why you have Angular. And that is why you have Node.js. And that is why you have frameworks, which are MVC frameworks and all. And I'm going to come to that. So, of course, that is something. The other thing which I will, of course, tell you later on, something which was not there in the profile when I was introduced. Now it has been like about 16, 17 years into the industry for me, and yours truly has whatever modestly contributed to the world in ways of, you know, what IT could be today. I mean, by the way, I was also on the Internet India Governance Forum to make internet-based policies for India. I was working with the then IT and Information Technology and Finance Ministry, as well as the Education Ministry. So, the point is, and I even worked with the government of Brazil and government of Malaysia, and I've also, you know, represented quite a few universities during my PhD work. I thought, why not share this journey with lot of people who are young, who are budding IT professionals, and who have no time to learn all these high-end technologies, but they have to learn it, and they have to learn it very well in shorter amount of time. Now, to do such an operation, to, you know, put the technology in the brains in shortest amount of time and most comprehensive way, you need experienced hands. And there is where people like yours truly would come into play. And of course, I also started a venture called Mentor Prize. So we mentor people to become enterprise ready. That's why I deliberately call it Mentor Prize, about which I will surely be telling you guys. It's a premium course system. I mean, you all guys know about Coursera and all, but they don't fulfill the need which I have modestly tried to fulfill, as in to not just teach a course, give an offline course and just let them learn. No, I would want to handhold and go ahead and mentor people right till their interview. That is what the aim is. So how open source, so I'll come to the whole core or the crux of the matter now. So how would open source be beneficial for your career? And also for your and also for the society, because now let me tell you, like, this is a thing of 2007-08 up till 2010-11. that people would say, okay, I'm doing proprietary work for my duty. I am actually working for some closed door company which makes some custom software. And in the evening, in the night, I'm an open source contributor. So it was like having two lives. So I have to contribute to the society. I have to contribute to my IT society in the first place. IT society is made of admins and developers and testers, you know, and end user consumers who actually consume things like Eclipse and Emacs or VS Code, and then writing libraries and all these are, this is what I call as the IT society. We have our own society as well. So that was the way it was, like two lives, you know. You have to have a dual personality. Now, that is the reason I said when my profile was read, it was quite outdated. Fast forward to 2017-18 up till now, you don't have to live two lives. If you are into IT, if you are into career, let me assure you, you are using open source. And even using open source and saying no to proprietary tools, saying no to tools which violate your privacy. Like, of course, you know, recently what happened with WhatsApp. You know, always I believe that jo bhi hota hai, achche ke liye hota hai. Yeah, we all have been exploited. But because of that thing, what happened on WhatsApp, what people like myself have been shouting all over the place. You know, jala Marathi madhe davandi pitavna mantat. We have been doing this with all the danka since what, 2007-8. Everyone, we have been telling like your privacy is getting violated. You are getting free Gmail. You are getting free WhatsApp. You are getting free Facebook. You think they are fools to give you free? They are actually violating your privacy. They are not taking money from you. They are taking much more than money. I would have said I would have better given money for all these services. So now people are slowly becoming aware of what their privacy rights are and what it means by having a community participation in any technology. So now open source has become the de facto, and even as a user of open source and saying no to such proprietary exploitatory things, you are actually contributing to a society. The reason being, the more there is a demand for community driven, you know, community participated open source softwares, wherein there will be there is definitely a management committee. Obviously, there has to be a control. You can't fly in all directions like a anarchical system, you know, jisko arajakta kehte hai. You know, the problem with free software, as per my modest understanding of this so many years, free software mein na arajakta hote, there is no control. But this flavor of free software, which is called open source, it is also free. It is community participated. You can contribute, like you or some of your people contributed to our projects. That was their career beginning. So it is happening now also. In open source also, it is the same thing. But in open source, there's a definite way of organizing, communicating, and coordinating amongst teams and inside the team. That is where, you know, career-wise also, when you talk about open source, what happens is that you are not just developing your technical skills, but you're developing your communication skills. You're developing yourselves as good humans, as civilized people, you know. So what do you do for career, and how does this open source thing affect your career? Now, one outcome or fallout of this entire open source revolution, guess what it is? Now, let's say I make a technology to write REST APIs. I hope everyone understands what REST API is, or at the end, I'll take question and answers, and that time I might as well tell you. And for those people who don't know, just in a nutshell, REST APIs are APIs, application programming interfaces. They are set of functions and classes and all, and they don't have an user interface. They are just functions, or they are just modules, so to speak. And there are only four operations possible with those modules. That is, either they can create data, they can update data, they can delete data, or they can read data. That is CRUD, CRUD. Okay. And you do it through one thing called JSON. So, you know, you send JSON objects and you receive JSON objects. It's like a Python dictionary, a key value pair, or associative arrays in PHP, or hash maps in Java. All these things have a common thread, or a common link, or a common junction, which is called JSON. Okay, JSON can be converted to a Java hash map, it can be converted to a PHP associative array, it can be converted to dictionaries in Python, you name it. Okay, and the best part of it is JSON is a plain string at the outset. So these REST APIs actually are made to provide functionality to third-party applications or front-ends. So that is the reason why nowadays you have the tax filing front-ends, you have the weather front-ends. You want to connect your software to, let's say, the Zoom API. Like you want to create your own online system and you want to connect. You don't want to write APIs or, you know, have programmers to write them. You can just connect to an API on the remote server and utilize them. Okay. Or let's say you're writing some kind of a game and then you want to, you know, integrate scoring system. So you don't have the time to write the scoreboard or scoring system system. You will use a third party system, not by installing it on your machine like a DLL. You don't have to install anything. You have to make the access available. Now, what has happened with this is it has given rise to a big industry called microservices. And microservices is a direct fallout of open source culture. And I deliberately use the word culture because open source is not just about writing softwares or creating APIs. Open source is about open knowledge sharing. Open source is about healthy competition. Open source is about innovatively marketing your things. And the core or crux behind, because there are a gamut of open source things available, and then there are a plethora of possibilities which you can use. So I have an API which is open, which means the source code is available. And then there is another person who's writing another set, few sets of APIs, and those are also open. Now, which means I can see your code and you can see my code because it's available on Git or, you know, GitHub or GitLab or whatever you want. And so I will say, hey, I mean, you know, your thing is a complementary to mine and mine is a complementary thing to yours. Why not standardize it in such a way that your thing can access mine and my thing can access yours. So initially there used to be such bubbles, you know, such give and take between one or two projects or two or three projects. Slowly as a time advanced, and when REST APIs became more common, and when everyone knew that you could trade in JSON, everyone started to open up their source code. And they will have standardized API protocols, absolutely standardized. There is a way to write certain thing. So which means if you're going to see my code beforehand, you know that I'm following a certain standard. If I see your code and if I see a problem, I would directly modify and help you out, because helping you is going to help me commercially as well. And vice versa. If you help my code, you're going to benefit commercially. I can give you best example. Like, you know, that is the reason you have to understand that to learn microservices, how important it is to for your career going ahead. So we are, as I said, a fintech company. Apart from the fact that I run my own foundation, I mean, that's another thing. As I said, this online khata, which I have developed, I told you already, you can go to onlinekhata.co.in and see that. We are a billing and invoicing and automation, accounting automation software. Now we want to give a tax filing service to our customers. Like now they're making invoices, their accounting entries are generated, but they have to file GST. I will not write GST code on myself. I will just access the government portal. They will be providing me some APIs. I will integrate those APIs in my system. Now, how will I integrate that? How do I know what they have written in their code? I don't have to. For a simple reason, I know they are following one standard called CRUD, which I told you some time back. Okay. And the CRUD has certain verbs like put, post, get, delete, all this. I'm not getting into technical stuff. This is not a technical session anyhow, but I have to make a mention to it. Now, once I know that, all that I have to have is a brief document of what the APIs do and what are their entry points and the names of those entry points. That's it. So when you are going ahead in your career from now on, please understand that the more you are a part of the open source community, the more you contribute to the open source community. And by the way, contribution comes right from documentation till coding. And right from using it till telling others to use it. You are going to be the pioneers in the industry. If at all you understand now, at least that open source is, I mean, who was the biggest opponent of open source? Who was the biggest enemy, so to speak, of open source? The people used to say, this is a cancer, which is going to be, we will eliminate that cancer and make our IT industry, disease free. It was Microsoft who said that, and today Microsoft is the one who gives you Visual Studio as open source. Azure uses Linux, of course, everyone knows that. So the people who used to speak most ill about open source have now started to use it. They have to adopt it. And by the way, this is the victory of the community, and this is the victory of at least 30 years been put by people like Richard Stallman to bring this revolution. And today, there is one very important concept one has to learn if you have to go to, you know, the industry in a short while. And I'm not sure whether you guys are noting down what I'm talking about, but there are certain important aspects and points which I'm talking about. That is, you have to understand that as a developer, you barely write code from scratch. You barely do that. It's like 20% of the time you may write code from scratch. Device driver writers and all are exceptions to it, but that industry is not there much in India anyhow. Most of the time you're going to get snippets, as what they call. Most of the time you get ready-made libraries. And most of the time your working hours are spent integrating open source components. That is what the industry is all about. And the entire paradigm of programming, what you call as programming, is changed now. And I am not even talking about machine learning and deep learning and, you know, artificial intelligence. I mean, I have not even touched on that subject. But even, in fact, that is the best example of what I'm talking, because if I talk about Python language, for example, which is so much in demand just because of machine learning and all, you have things like NumPy, SciPy, and all the libraries which are there, Pandas and all this. Now, a few years back, if we were doing such things, you would have to really write hardcore code, because not a lot of libraries were available open source. And the libraries which were open source were not so good. They were not so good quality. Why they were not good quality? Because someone did it for time pass. And that time, the image of free software or open source is that jisko hum log bolte na Marathi mein phukat se milta hai, muft ka mil raha hai. What has happened in the last 5 years is open source has got the industry status, as in people invest money into open source. A lot of startups started and they have to use open source. But now, how do you make this open source better? Because you need it. You have to make your career. You have to have good tools. You don't have to pay. The companies are not ready to pay a lot of money to buy very costly. Forget about you and me. Even companies don't pay money to buy costly proprietary technologies. The only way you can cook food in your house is to light your gas. If you can't light your chula, there will be no fire. And if there is no fire, you cannot cook food. So the way you can get your own career, the way you can get open source working, is to contribute to it. That is the reality of today. So, and then I shouldn't be even saying this, because whether or not you like it, whether or not you know it, you are actually right now working. Jitsi, which you are using right now, is also an open source thing, by the way. So I know a few companies who are taking Jitsi and making commercial versions of that, adding their own enterprise. One of my friend is also working on such a technology. So what happens is that you, of course, contribute to the society because it's open source, and you know, people get, those who cannot afford it can get it for free anytime. But those who can afford, like companies, they would pay for extra features. They would pay for enterprise, you know, enterprise versions. Like, I'll give you a simple example how this whole thing works. So there are public grounds all over the place. In Aurangabad, of course, I'm sure there is one. I had been to one such place where there was some program happening. In Mumbai, we have a place called Shivaji Park. Okay. There is a very funny anecdote, Shivaji used to come and park his horse in that area. That's why it's called Shivaji Park. Just that some people used to say such things. And then if you can say something very convincingly, people also believe in you. I have done this myself several times. That is the reason I said, I'm going to tell you that I'm just making a joke. So there are such places wherein you can go and wander. You can sit and chit chat with your friends. You can have a bit of food and all. They don't charge you anything, right? I mean, there must be such public parks and all in Aurangabad also. But tomorrow, let's say I want to keep a program, let's say some rock show or some minister's speech or some huge marriage or something like that. Will they allow me to do, will the municipality allow me to do it for free? No, they won't. They will say that you have to pay charges for that same place where everyone goes free. I will be told to pay charges. Why? Because now I'm asking for a customized service. I'm saying that for a day, I want to book, let's say half of that area, I want to book for myself and no one should be allowed inside. So which means I'm asking for a customized service and which means I'm asking for some specific thing to be done only for me, utilizing that same free space. This is how open source is. You download Django, you download Node.js and use it. You download React, you use it. You download Angular, you use it. You do anything you want. You download MongoDB, you use it. There is no problem. You can even contribute back to it, which is a very good habit. You must contribute to open source. But the moment you have to do something seriously commercial and you need some help and you need some specifics, of course they will charge you and they have the right to charge you. And that is where the open source industry flourished. And that is why today open source has become the de facto standard for the career. So what all are the options which actually make this such an interesting arena? Of course, I've told you that for machine learning and artificial intelligence and data analysis, all these things are there. Of course, there is Python. Of course, there is R. Okay, R is also being used very, very often. There is one thing which I would want to tell you, which I don't know how many of you have been already told or you know, or you may not be even aware of. There is one language which sadly is not taught in any universities here and is also taught in very few universities abroad. That is called the Clojure. Okay. To go to the base or root of this, there is a base language called Lisp, L-I-S-P, P for parrot, Lisp. Okay. Now, here is a surprise. Who do you think uses this Clojure and Lisp and stuff like that? It is used by Facebook, Amazon and company. All these huge guys, Tesla, these guys use it. So just think about it. If you know something like a Clojure, something like Lisp, what kind of an edge you would be having to go for higher jobs? So that is one option. There is a downside to this. Such jobs are not easily available and such jobs won't come to you without experience. I mean, I won't hire a newbie who knows Clojure for that matter. But then of course, everyone is a newbie at some time and everyone becomes experienced at some time. So that is a process. Just wanted to tell you that such things are also available and used at a very, very high level. Then of course, there are two parallels which are going on right now in the industry, which are the only two parallels, so to speak. All the others are behind now. All the others are on like second, third, fourth position. And you know, they have gone far, far behind now. One is the Python stream, wherein you have Python-based frameworks like Pyramid, like Django, like Flask. Okay, these are the words you should be knowing in your career, by the way. And all Lumpy and all other things. That is one way of going to it. There is the other stream, which is a JavaScript based stream. Now, there is an interesting thing which has happened in last about eight years, I should say, right from 2012 and on. When things like Ajax started to become popular, and for those people who don't know what Ajax is, you know, when you're using Facebook or when you're using Twitter, you get a feeling as if you're using a desktop based app. The page doesn't keep refreshing. But new data keeps on coming. The screen gets updated without your entire page getting refreshed. In the olden days, if you have to get new information, your page will refresh, right? But nowadays, just a part of the page gets refreshed and the page is updated. That is called asynchronous JavaScripting, you know, Ajax, asynchronous JavaScripting and XML, which means that without refreshing the entire page, without completing a full refresh after a response, when you send a request, you get a response and a full refresh of the page. Only a part of it gets refreshed by manipulating the document object model, of course. When this thing started to become popular, a lot of JavaScript enthusiasts came to the forefront and contributed a big thing to the society, which is called JavaScript UI library frameworks. Something like Angular is a framework or a React is a library. These things started to come up when Ajax became very popular. And again, what happened is a lot of people contributed to it as open source projects, a lot of them. And at the end, what happened? Because they contributed to Angular and React or Vue.js, what apparently happened is that these libraries improved, their quality improved. Because of that, what happened? We started to create very, very good applications in no time. Because of that, what happened? Technology cost came down drastically. And because of that, what happened? Even poor people started to afford technologies. So this is a chain. This is a chain. Since ma'am talked about, you know, contributing to the society. Today, if you make your career in open source, you are inadvertently or advertently, knowingly or unknowingly, liking it or unlikingly, contributing to the society anyhow. You need not be a communist and, you know, go shouting in Zindabad, Murdabad to help the society. That's not needed. Okay. You need not do your work for free and still you can contribute to the society. Then what happened is, simultaneously, there was another thing going on in the background, and I'm deliberately using the word background. So there was a time when you would use JavaScript for the front end and Python or Java or PHP would be used for the back end. But some guys thought, hey, why not? Since JavaScript is so fast, the engines are so optimized these days, why can't we start writing back end code as well as in JavaScript? So Node.js was really given a hype. And as a result, slowly till 2015, there was a turning point in 2015. Okay. What happened is Node.js became such a matured thing that it did not require a web browser to execute JavaScript. Okay. Otherwise, JavaScript, prior ye mana jata hai ki JavaScript ko browser mein hi chalana hai aur JavaScript browser ke bina nahi chalta hai. Lekin ab aisa nahi hai. Now the situation has changed. It was believed that it was only running in Chromium or Firefox or whatever. Now you can take, so what the smart people did, this is again a magic of open source. Now Google has launched its browser Chrome and Chromium. Chromium is the open source one, by the way. Open source as in the source code is also available. They have a JavaScript engine which is highly optimized and super fast. They made it open source. See what happens when such a thing is done. Now the Node.js guys thought, hey, this is an opportunity for us. Let's, you know, we anyways want to be independent of a browser. So what do we need? We need an interpreter, a just-in-time compiler, just like Java has. And we need a runtime environment, just like Java has. All that they got into that from that engine, the 8 version. Now, once that happened, there was a big, big, big revolution. In 2015, the ECMS 6 specification came out. And today, I don't know, a lot of you must be writing JavaScript code. Many of you may not know this. But today you can actually create classes the way you do in kind of the way you do it in Java or Python, almost like that. And then there are arrow functions and then there are bind functions and stuff like that, which is a result of the ECMAScript 6. Now add this fact of, you know, doing pure object oriented programming with REST APIs at the backend. So the other parallel line to Python is the Node.js line. And there are millions of libraries available to do just about anything. But then how do you make a choice in your career? If you're going towards scientific applications or artificial intelligence, which involves a lot of computation. And by computation, I mainly mean mathematical computation, but there are other computations also, image recognition, for example. Then you better go the Python or the R way, because JavaScript is faster. JavaScript is quick. JavaScript may be slightly easier to maintain than Python. In fact, Python code is, to me, if you ask me personally, it is the most easy to maintain. But of course, debatably, JavaScript is much easier than that. Okay. But JavaScript lacks that computational and mathematical power which Python over the years has built. JavaScript may build in the long run. Maybe some of you might do that as an open source work. But right now it's not there. So if you want to go that way, then of course Python is your way. But friends, let me tell you this. In about 10-12 years back, there was a very, very interesting thing happening in the film industry side. There was a certain guy who neither had talent, who neither had anything. He had a certain different talent, but he got into a totally different thing and simply became popular because he was hyped and everyone wanted to hear him. His name is Himesh Reshmiya. He's an excellent guitarist, let me tell you, but he shouldn't be singing. Now, apart from the joke, why I'm giving you this example? Nowadays, jisko koi main dekh raha hu, sab logon ko ek hi cheez karna hai, machine learning and artificial intelligence. It's a great field beyond doubts. It's a great field. But everyone can't be Sachin Tendulkar, right? So think about what you want to do. Just because everyone is saying, oh, AI and machine learning doesn't mean ki iske alawa koi duniya hi nahi hai. No, it's not like that. It is a very important part. It's a very important thing. And those who want to go and those who know what they are going to do in that, because just by saying main machine learning karunga aur main AI karunga doesn't suffice it. You have to particularly know usme kya karna hai. Do you want to work on natural language processing? Do you want to work on image recognition? Do you want to work on computations for like astronomical applications? What do you want to do in artificial intelligence and machine learning? Kya karna hai? You know, ye to aisi baat ho gayi ki when you go to the doctor and you say, a doctor puchta hai kya ho gaya, aap bolte ho main bimar hu. Are ab bimar hu isliye to mere paas aaye ho, doctor bolega. But you have to be very specific na, kya bimari ho gayi hai. Aajkal ek hi bimari zyada hoti hai, alag baat hai. So be very specific about what do you want to do in artificial intelligence. Just because someone says don't go, just because you heard about it and you heard, arre yaar 4 lakh ka package milta hai, 10 lakh ka package milta hai, but what do you want to do? I know people working in AI jinko 60-70,000 rupaye hi milte hai mahine ke, and I know jinko 7-8 lakh bhi milte hai. Aap log kya karna chahte ho, kis tarah se karna chahte ho, kitne time mein karna chahte ho, and what's your goal? So what are the other streams? The other possibility is to go into, you know, application development and UI development. And by the way, it's no more a simple thing to do. You know, when you are writing UI, you have to see to it that it works on so many devices now. In the initial days, kya tha? You write a software, it has to work on it on different screens of a laptop or a desktop. And what were those screen sizes? 15-inch se leke 21-inch tak tha bas. Iske beech mein hi sab kuch tha. There was no concept called responsive UIs. To the extent that when I came to your college in 2017, I guess, 80 to 90% of the people gave me wrong answers of what responsive UI is. There was a girl who said, sir, wo request bhejte aur response aata hai aur UI badalta hai, usko responsive UI bolte hai. Iska matlab kya hua? Iska matlab ye hua that we just don't know about it. So now writing UI is a complex affair. It's a career in itself. Initially writing UI was just a part of your work, just a part of your project. You couldn't say that my UI bana ke career banaoga. Nowadays UI specialists are there. And there is also one concept called UX. And no better person than me can tell you, because my PhD itself is about human computer interface. So user experience. You may have a very good UI. It looks good. It works fast. It does its task well, but I may not want to use it because I don't get a good experience. And there might be a UI as simple as a Google search form, where there is just one button and one search field. And then there is, I am feeling lucky and stuff, and I get the best experience using it. I will never go away from Google. That is the difference between writing good looking UIs or functional UIs and giving a good UX. Please remember this because it's very important for your careers. Okay. So that's another field. Then there is another field, which is the field of writing microservices. So you don't write nowadays a complete software and tightly integrate it into a box. You will have separate boxes, and you will connect those boxes with wires as and when you need those boxes. You may not need all of them. So what is the wire? The wire is your HTTP protocol. That is never going to go. By the way, there are some things which we must understand that which should never go. These are like the basics. I mean, I don't know how the camera is clear. If you guys can see, there's something behind me. I have an old gramophone showpiece kept behind me. Okay. Today we listen to music. Today we listen to whatever we want to. It's all digital. But what is the end of it? There are some zeros and ones on your CD or in your MP3, this thing. At the end of the day, those digits, that stream, those bits and bytes have to be converted to an electrical impulse, which in turn has to be sent to an analog amplifier, which has to actually amplify the volume and send it to the speakers to make the sound. So at the end of the day, sab kuch le de ke aake, ghum fir ke aa jata hai analog technology pe. I am a collector of records, you know, this old 1960s and all 70s. I have a huge collection, right? For the people who are really hip, I have Pink Floyd, Beatles and all their original records, huge LP records, which are the size of your thali. Okay, and I play them. And the sound which comes from them, of course, you have to maintain your equipment very well, your instruments very well. There is no match in digital world for an analog sound. Because at the end of the day, everything what you hear, when you are hearing me now, it's analog. Our ears are meant to work on analog system. So, mere piche wohi pada hai gramophone player. So, aap kuch bhi karo, you write microservices, you write your web applications, you write whatever, your HTTP is never going to go away. There is nothing beyond that. HTTP, FTP, these internet transfer protocols will never go away. They are the analogs, they are the power of your entire system. Aage chalke aap kuch bhi karo uspe. Ajax karo, nahi karo, it doesn't make a difference. So having a fairly good understanding of what HTTP is, and this is a place where I feel that I did the right thing by starting my venture called Mentor Prize. Why? Because there are two ways of approaching towards learning something, to learning a technology, to learning or gaining knowledge. Okay. There are two extremes, guys. One extreme is the academic way, wherein, you know, I know a lot of you guys hate your professors behind the back and bahut bura bhala bola jata hai. Main bhi bola karta tha mere college days mein. Sab log karte hai wo, there is nothing new in that, and even your professors know it. Lekin wo unka dosh nahi hai na aapka dosh hai, because the academical system is to, you know, ye jo khichdi cook karte na slow flame pe. So academic system, yes, it is like, you know, they will cook you very slowly. Each and every concept has been to be slowly put into your head. Theory baad mein karenge. You know, when like I have learned a bit of classical music, and you know, they will teach you Sare Gama Pa Dha Ni Sa for about, like, let's say 2 months. Every note should be like very, very specific in your mind. So there is this academic approach of teaching IT, wherein you start from the very basics, understand input, understand output, understand what is what, and slowly, slowly you grab concepts and then you move advanced. Okay, that's one way of it. That is the way your academics work. And that's why we find it so boring. So it is very boring. It takes so much time. But the thing is, aapka concepts to bahut strong ho jata isse. But who has the time to do that, right? So there is another approach, which is called a cookbook approach, wherein you come up with a problem. You search on the net or you talk to your teacher. You get the ready-made code. And they explain you what the code is, or you read the code and try to understand what the code does and get your task done. It takes very less time. Okay. You want to write a blogging system. You need to know what tools you need. And then you take those libraries, you put them together. You write a bit of your own code to fuse them together, and kaboom, your thing is done. It's over. Okay. You had a problem with some tools and some basic knowledge, you actually fixed it and made it work. Now, the biggest advantage of this is what? You actually did something workable or an application which does some tasks in such a short time. There is a problem with this, a huge problem with this. You will be only able to solve that task or a bit beyond that. 19-20 thoda. But if there's a different scenario, there's a different situation, there is a different thing to do, you won't be able to do it. Why? Because in this case, the concept is totally absent. I might show you some code in JavaScript right away. Of course, I'm not going to do that because aise bhi log coding se itne tang aa chuke, I don't want to do that. And I will explain you that code, var something, okay, this, that. But if I don't tell you that there is also one thing called let, you can declare a variable. There's a difference between writing var and let. Next time you see let in something, some code, or you see a nested function, you will not understand because aapke pehle problem mein ye concept ka kaam nahi aaya tha. So the downside is you won't be technology engineers. You will just be like troubleshooters. Like jo log cricket dekhte na, 7th or 8th batsman aata hai, 2-4 boundary lagata hai, 1-2 sixer laga ke out ho jata hai. Such people never, if you want quick runs, they are a good option. But if you want someone to stand and deliver for like entire day or koi badi century marni hai, to ye log kisi kaam ke nahi hote. So I thought there is a problem which I have to solve here. The problem is that we all teach and we all learn. I thought, no, if I have to make people enterprise ready, then I should mentor them. Why? Because today teaching has very little significance because sab kuch internet pe hai. If I put a single question on Google, how to do da 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 da, mil jayega. I would say getting started basic Node.js tutorials with proper explanation, mil jayega, with practicals, mil jayega. Okay. So there is no point in teaching. Of course, with academics, it's a different thing because वहाँ पे एक तरीका होता है आपको सिखाने का, because it's your graduate course, which is very necessary, or a master's course, which is very necessary. It is kind of your strong foundation, वो तो जरूरी है. But then, it is not going to make you enterprise ready in just a while. Okay. At the same time, cookbook approach लेके problem क्या होगा? How many problems can I solve for you? How many solutions can I give you? Like, should I feed a poor person or should I make him to learn how to make his own, earn his own food? That is the question. So the second approach also has a problem. I thought I will create a third approach wherein I will make you learn concepts, but learning those concepts will happen from practicals. So iska matlab there is a dive in head first or a cookbook approach, but an alternated cookbook approach wherein I am not going to give you just a solution for a problem. Yes, we will talk about solution and a problem, but in that example, there will be a definite concept, and that concept will be such a thing that you will be able to prove for yourself that we will give you another problem. You will be able to solve it within no time. Something which your colleagues might have taken to understand or learn in 6 months, you would learn in 6 days. The reason being, yes, you will be actually solving a problem or you will be actually working on some things. There is a prerequisite for that. But while we solve a problem, while we get a solution, we will learn concepts through it. And I got this idea for a very simple reason. When I used to talk with students, when I used to take interviews for jobs and all, if I ask a certain person and someone comes who says I'm an expert in, let's say, you know, Node.js. And I ask the person, okay, tell me, I want to do an inter-service communication between two Node.js applications. Now, what do I do? He'll start with, sir, for example, main express mein code likhunga, aur wo code mein na main HTTP ka request. And this has happened with me several times. Initially, I used to get angry, but now I realize, hey, this is the way they talk. They will talk about a practical example, but they understand the concept in it. So why not mentor people to become enterprise ready? And this is specifically required for people who have got campus placed, but now they have to really learn some technologies because college mein to utna zyada ho nahi pata hai because of all the practicals and journal submissions and ye and wo and all the formalities nahi ho pata hai, really fact hai. And those people jinko job mila hai abhi unko suddenly unke boss ne bol diya bhai naya project hai, naya technology aur platform hai, aapko seekhna padega, and they don't have the time a lot, 2 or 3 months to learn. They just have, let's say, 1 month to learn or something like that, or 6 weeks to learn. What they will do? So this is going to be a premium kind of a, I wouldn't say course, it's kind of a mentoring platform. And of course, I am doing it because I have got 15 odd years of experience and I know exactly how things are to be put into the brains of people without stressing them. That is the most important thing. Okay. So that is why we call it like mentor prize. We mentor you to make enterprise ready. So there are certain aspects you have to understand. Number one, I guess a lot of people know what a full stack is, stack framework. Okay. There are stacks. Like there's the Ming stack.
Fuyas. 49 minutes.
Okay, then there is this LAMP stack, Apache MySQL Linux PHP thing. Okay, VAMP, LAMP, whatever it is, XAMPP. But today that is not the case. Today you cannot survive on that. Two things are very, very, very important. Number one, your stack should be multi-platform. I mean, your stack as in your knowledge base, your repertoire in your brain, what you know, what you understand, should be a multi-platform approach. मैं पाइथन जानता हूं बस, इसके आगे मैं कुछ नहीं करूंगा. आई एम नॉट गोइंग टू गेट जॉब्स वेरी सून. ओके, योर अप्रोचेस हैव टू बी मल्टी स्टैक्ड. यू हैव टू नो पाइथन एज वेल एज जावास्क्रिप्ट, और लेट्स से जावा एज वेल एज रूबी, व्हाटएवर. ओके, दैट्स वन थिंग विच यू मस्ट अंडरस्टैंड, दैट इट इज नॉट गोइंग टू बी अ सिंगल स्टैक थिंग. एंड सेकेंडली, देर इज अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट कॉन्सेप्ट कॉल्ड मॉडल व्यू कंट्रोल, MVC. Or it is also called as model view template, MVT. Okay, wherein the logic, the database, and the interface are all three separate components which are joined through some means. And there is a particular way of doing things. So these are two things which you must understand, and that's going to be needed. Otherwise, your careers, and careers, when I say career, I mean in your open source careers, because open source hi hota hai aajkal sab kuch. Are not going to progress because till now there is no proper approach in any universities in India which will give you a very practical orientation towards model view control or towards what I was talking about, a multi-stack framework kind of a thing. People still don't understand what a multi-stack framework is. And lastly, the most important factor is that you need to understand whether you do machine learning, whether you do artificial intelligence, whether you are working on some web application backend, you are by and by going to deal with microservices, which are small components which you put together. So all this is suggesting what? That your approach and your attitude towards learning things is going to be totally different. You know, professors are sitting in this session, I can very well assure they will associate one thing. एक जमाने में विजुअल बेसिक होता था. सो यू राइट योर फ्रंट एंड, इन दैट फॉर्म इटसेल्फ देयर विल बी समथिंग कॉल्ड सब रूटीन. यू राइट योर कोड इन दैट, तो डेटाबेस का कनेक्टिविटी भी वहीं पे है, यूआई का रेंडरिंग भी वहीं पे है, एंड देन द कनेक्शंस आर आल्सो देयर ऑल इन वन. ओके, एंड देन स्लोली यू स्टार्टेड टू एडवांस टू समथिंग लाइक एंटरप्राइज जावा बीन्स एंड ऑल. तो थोड़ा मल्टी टीयर हो गया था, बट स्टिल इट वॉज टाइटली कपल्ड. मुझे पूरा सिस्टम जावा में ही लिखना पड़ेगा. There will be a front end, there will be a back end. Java Swing में front end होगा, back end में enterprise Java beans होंगे, blah 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 blah. वही. Now we have passed everything. Your back end will be in Python, your middleware might be in Java, and your front end is in, let's say, React or Angular. Friends, that is the way today's industry is working. And lastly, which I deliberately did not mention in the initial this thing. Just like there is a hype about machine learning and deep learning and this artificial intelligence, which I said, you go for it, sure, it's a great career, but know what you particularly want to do. There is another thing jiski bahut hype chalti hai, lekin it is not a one shoe fit all solution. Wo har cheez ke liye chalta nahi hai. And guess what is that? That is what you call as the NoSQL databases, object databases like MongoDB, Couchbase, etc., etc. These are great solutions. These are very, very, very fast databases. Your traditional SQL databases cannot even match their speed. Let me tell you, out of the box, they cannot even match with their speed. But there's a problem. If you are going to assume that SQL databases are going to be eradicated from the world like dinosaurs, then you are on a completely wrong path. You are heading towards your own doomsday. SQL databases are not just here to stay, but they are becoming hybrid now. They also give you JSON-like features, like NoSQL-like features. PostgreSQL, by the way, has a data type called JSON, just to tell you. Okay. Again, here I will say, aap samjho aap kya karne wale ho. What kind of career you are doing? You are going to become specialist in financial technologies. Don't even think of object databases. Why? Because when you are playing with people's money, that ACID compliance is really necessary. Varna hoga ye, आप एटीएम कार्ड में एटीएम डालोगे, आपका पैसा तो डिडक्ट हो जाएगा लेकिन पैसा निकलेगा नहीं. टुडे दैट डजंट हैपन, राइट? इफ द मनी डजंट कम आउट ऑफ द एटीएम, योर ट्रांजेक्शन इज ऑल्सो रिवर्स, योर मनी इज सेफ. सच थिंग्स कैन हैपन विद अ डेटाबेस विच इज हैविंग एसिड कंप्लायंस, द कंसिस्टेंसी ऑफ डेटाबेस, द रोल बैक्स एंड द कमिट्स सो टू स्पीक, एंड एसोसिएटेड डेटा with no SQL databases. Why they are very fast? Because there is no such system. You have to take care. As a developer, you are responsible for that. Which means आपके कोड में गलती हो गई तो आपका वही होगा जो चंद्रयान के साथ हुआ. Not that चंद्रयान में commit और rollback का problem था, वो problem testing का था. That also brings me to a thing that testing also is a very great career actually. So when you are hearing about MongoDB and all, it's not that, you know, there is an end of the world for MySQL or PostgreSQL. No, they are still going to be there. So make a conscious decision of what technologies you want to learn. And that is where people like me who bring up mentor prize becomes very necessary. Because someone has to be there to advise you, not just like ye technology aage to uske piche bhagna shuru karo. It is not the way. That's not the way it works. Okay. The same thing used to be with open source. People just thought open source hai toh chalo theek hai. No, but then open source also has to be of good quality. And when it will become of good quality? When you contribute to it. That is the reason why I hope you have noted all these things. To summarize, open source is the de facto standard today. You are all using open source. There is no company which doesn't use open source today. No company, bet me on that. And you have to understand that now when you learn things, you cannot learn a single technology and leave it. You have to have a multi-platform approach. Your stack should be multi-platform. And today people develop systems in a particular way called a model view control approach. And that is the reason when you learn language, it is good. It is very, very necessary that you learn programming language. But it is also required that you learn proper libraries. There are lots of libraries which are very well developed. But beyond that, the most essential thing, jo aap nahi karoge to career mein kuch nahi hoga, is to learn frameworks. You choose your frameworks. You can choose Django, you can choose Node.js, whichever way you want to go. You choose your frameworks. But knowing frameworks and knowing libraries and being multi-platform approached is very, very, very important. Because if you don't do it, then you are certainly outdated. I mean, no one works without microservices and multi-platform approaches now. If you go to interviews and say, sir, wo to nahi malum, you are already losing out. So I hope I have made things clear in perspective of what actually things are. And of course, if you want to write down my email address, because this venture for you guys, especially I have started for the freshers called Mentor Prize, wherein, you know, I will be mentoring and there will be other dignified people who would be coming and talking to you as well. And right till the interview, we do the mentoring. Those who want to know about it, of course, you can note down my email address. It is KKPROGHUB, KKPROGHUB. You know, I have a programming hub. There's a YouTube channel by that name. Okay. So KK as in Krishnakant. So KK. ProgHub, KKPROGHUB, KKPROGHUB@gmail.com. You can write to me anytime. I will give you more details about what Mentor Prize is and, you know, what all we do in Mentor Prize and how you can join, the fees, etc., etc. So that is it. But please keep this. Just one bit of advice in mind. I am also not all pervasive Brahma Gyani or something. I also keep learning every day. But I have learned one thing that I have to learn. And that is most important, because we think that ek-do technology aa gayi. And I have met some very arrogant programmers, by the way, who think that they write good code, so they are like great. But the problem is, as I said in the very beginning, nowadays you don't write code much. You mostly get into integration. So please understand concepts, please understand microservices, please understand REST API, please learn at least one framework. Please understand that you have to be multi-stacked, and please understand that AJAX and MVC architecture is something which you must be aware of. So I hope I have not bored you guys. This is just a bit of my own journey which I shared with you. And being a director and a CTO of a company, as well as running an NGO, I know what it takes to actually contribute to a society as well as to do a good business. Because a lot of students sitting here, abhi man mein ye chalo yaar, main job nahi karunga, main to startup chalo karne wala, which is a really good thing, because one startup you make, you are actually going to create jobs for a lot of people. So, you know, that is the reason why a lot of colleges have this center of excellence and all that. Take advantage of such things. Take advantage of incubators, take advantage of startup consultants, and do make your business. But if you don't want to do that, of course, if you want to do a career as a tech developer or as an admin or as a microservice expert, yes, that's also something which you can do. For that, which of course I have given you whatever modest knowledge I have. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir, for such a knowledgeable session. I hope all the students have received it very deeply. As you said, approach and attitude should be different nowadays, right?
Yeah.
Because the people are continuously going in the programming and they are just thinking that if the trend is like that, then go for that. But rather than that, whatever you just told, I will just, in short, I will tell, or again, I will just repeat it. See, students, you should set your goals exactly in which technology you would like to explore. That you have to decide. And why? Yes. See, do not run toward the high package salary, because your interest and the exact objective, that if you decide it correctly, then you will not check what the package is, because ultimately it will lead to the highest salary, but that is important. Then apart from that, just in the cricketing language, you told that rather than becoming tail-ender batsman, you have to stand and deliver and should be consistent throughout the whatever you are doing.
Yeah, because you know, a great batsman can always behave like a tail-ender and use the long handle, but the reverse is not possible.
Exactly.
So, you know, you will get high packages definitely, but if you just run after high packages, you will go there, you will get a campus placement. In a year or two, you will be out. What will be the use of that?
Very rightly, sir. Yes, sir. True. And if just to told you, for us also, you told that rather than having just learning the traditional learning, mentoring is the most important thing nowadays.
Yes,
you have to facilitate them because so many things are available already. Okay. Thank you, sir. I would like to take few questions. Some students have raised few questions, so I would like to on behalf of them, I would like to ask how and what and in what way I can contribute in open source community. That is the question from Sarang.
Sarang, as I said in the very beginning, even if you use open source technology and make it a point that you will, and you are a technology guy, I mean, you are not a common man. It's very easy for me to say this to you then, that even using an open source tool, you might say, no, I will not use a proprietary integrated environment. I will use something like Visual Code or Emacs. I will not use proprietary Java thing. I will use open source Java. I will use OpenJDK or I will use JavaScript. That's one thing. I mean, that's an entry point, using it and seeing to it that people understand. The second thing is you should contribute. See how you contribute. When you go to a site of any project, you like, you choose any project, you choose Tomcat or you choose, let's say, Apache, you choose PHP, you choose Python.org, wherever you go, there will be a section called contribute. They have their own Git repositories. And I hope you understand what Git repository is, that the source code is versioned and maintained at a certain place. You join that community, you become a member, you watch for some days, you'll immediately grab that there is some problem, which there are 10 problems. You'll understand that is the first thing, 10 bugs or 10 problems. Out of that, you might think, okay, this one I can solve. All that you have to do is to write a mail to them and say, I can solve this and I have this patch. Then you give it, they screen it. And if it works fine, that's it. You have already made your contribution. And not just that, you also become famous because you made it. So it is not that rocket science. It's not that difficult. The third thing is you can write documentation, which is very important. Imagine you get a library. Your boss says that you have to use this library to do this task. And there is no documentation of what the functions mean and how they are. What are you going to do? How much time will it take to read the source code? But if that library is well documented, the functions are there, everyone will want to use that library, right? So writing documentation is also, that is, these are three ways, most common ways which I can think you can contribute.
Okay, thank you, sir. Apart, second question, apart, it is from Vaishnavi. Apart from Red Hat, OpenShift, what are the other technologies where we can make career as an open source developer or tool developer?
I think you have already written down quite a lot of things which I told. So Node.js is something which, you know, it's a heaven of tools, basically. It's a paradise of tools. So Node.js is a complete platform. By the way, let me make this very clear here. People feel that Node.js is a framework or a language. No, it's not. What Node.js is, nothing but JavaScript, but Node.js, just like Java is a platform, Node.js is a platform. And a lot of tools are developed. The other thing is, you must concentrate on, if you're asking me this question, there are things like Kubernetes and Docker, which you should really, really be into if you want to make some good career.
Okay, thank you, sir. Next question from Sachin. In what way I will be get connected with DFF?
Well, we do a lot of activities and, you know, we do mentor a lot of people. We do internships. So, of course, I've shared my email address to you. And, of course, we can talk about that on a wider scale. And most probably, we are now looking at people who can write components for our financial, open source financial software. Because, you know, it's our aim to benefit the rural businesses, the rural enterprises, the small and micro ones. So you are most welcome to contribute to that. You can write down to me and I can tell you what prerequisites are needed. I mean, as in your knowledge-based prerequisites are needed. That I will tell you for sure.
Okay, I will take another question. And then I will tell all the students that just sir has given the email ID. So you can connect with email ID and whatever the different types of queries are there, even if after the program, you can mail all the queries. Right, sir?
Yeah, sure.
So one question, when a whole world will become an open source technological world?
Well, I mean, see, it's like this, that right now that the case is already so that everyone is using it. The question, I will actually change the question. It should be, when will whole world contribute back to open source? Because I think now there is not, even Apple has Apple public license and they release almost quite a lot of things in open source. So it's not about when the world will use it open source. It's about when will everyone contribute? See, now we talked about privacy. Now the WhatsApp has triggered the entire privacy campaign. Now our clients on my own portal, they ask me, sir, hamari privacy kaise ensure karte ho? Initially, no one cared damn about this privacy thing. Koi kisi ko nahi padhi thi. Now suddenly everyone is talking about privacy. So there are such triggers which happen, which keep on happening and which will happen. Ek time aisa aayega, and I think it's not far away, maybe 5-6 years down the line, that everyone will be knowing ki hum log jo use kar rahe hain, wo koi ek bande ne ya bandi ne banaya hua nahi hai. It's a work of so many communities far abroad. It's like, this is how societies evolve in the world, right? So वो अभी बहुत जल्दी आएगा टाइम.
ओके, थैंक यू वेरी मच सर. एंड जस्ट आई टोल्ड दैट यू कैन डायरेक्टली हैव योर क्वेरीज एंड कैन फॉरवर्ड इट टू सर. द ईमेल आईडी ऑलरेडी सर हैज शेयर्ड.
या अगेन फॉर दोज हु वांट इट, इट्स केके प्रोग हब, दैट इज केके PROGHUB, प्रोग एज इन प्रोग्रामिंग, केके प्रोग हब, हब एज इन गिटहब. ओके, केके PROGHUB@gmail.com. वेरी वेरी इजी.
Yes, thank you. Now it is the time for vote of thanks. First of all, I would like to say thank you very much to Krishnakant Mane sir. From his busy schedule, he has taken the time and he has so much of knowledgeable session he has given to all of us. And I hope all these students have gone deep into that and they will think over all the points which sir has raised. Okay, apart from that, what are the different types of motivational things he has told? You should take it into consideration and you should flourish your life and as well as the software development process. You have to think about that once again and exactly what you are doing. That also you have to again, what you can say, you have to rethink about that. The different aspects are there now. And in that way, you have to think because the world is changing continuously and change is the only permanent thing, as so many people always focus on this particular point. I am very thankful to sir and I would like to say thank you very much to head of department, Dr. Smita L. Kasar ma'am. Actually, she is not feeling well. Thank you very much, ma'am, for guiding the students for and they joined it and they have taken the helpful. They have taken good information from me, sir. And I'm also thankful to Dr. B.S. Sonane, sir. He is in the background. He's handling all the technical details. And the streaming is also going on because of him. So thank you very much, sir. And all the faculties which have joined and we have stopped all the things and they have listened patiently and they are thinking. They have also taken the time and they have also listened all the details from sir. So thank you to all of them. And last but not the least, all the students who have joined, SY, TY and BTech students, and they have listened it carefully. So thank you to all of them. And now it's over to Sonane, sir. Sir?
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your nice vote of thanks. Now the officially the program is over here, but we will have the interaction with the couple of students of final year. So now I would like to request all the students to please leave this interaction because of this is already over. And I will request respected Krishnakant Mane sir, respected head of the department, Madam Smita Madam, to please stay tuned with us. Very soon, 14 students will join this program. Thank you all.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Here I will declare the program is over. Thank you all of you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Streaming.